Hi guys, welcome to the third webinar of the combined Naldehli and Ovastehli. For today's session, we have with us Avni Singh, who is an IoT security analyst at Airtel. So I'll pop her up on the screen.
Hi guys, I'm Avni.
Hi Avni.
Sir. Hello.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, sir, I'm good. Difficult times we're living in. I hope everybody is good.
Yeah, I guess everyone is safe and everyone is good. And yeah, so without wasting much more time, I'll hand over the controls to you.
Okay. Sure. Hi, everyone. I am Avni, and I'll be your speaker for today. Privileged to be speaking at the NULL chapter. So I'll be speaking on data sniffing over air gaps. Before starting with the presentation and the talk, I would give a brief introduction about me. I do not fancy putting a who am I slide in the presentation, so I'll tell you verbally. I'm Avni, and I'm currently working as an IoT security analyst at Airtel. My focus is mainly hardware security, IoT security, firmware security, and all such things. And I found this passion, discovered this passion at NULL. So I'm very grateful to them. So 2-3 years back, when we went as a class to NULLcon, there was a CTF that was being organized there. And it was a hardware CTF by Quarks Lab. We played it and we won. And then since that time, for the last 3 years, we've been bagging awards consecutively. I've also been a speaker at NULLcon this year. So very privileged for that too. We'll start with the talk and I'll go through the agenda first of all. So the agenda for today is to understand what an air gap is. What is an air gap environment, or what an air gap system or network is. Then we'll go on to discuss why do we need such an expensive setup, because air gap is a very expensive setup to have, and not you will not find everyday organizations putting in such type of setup in place. So why is there a need for such an expensive setup? Then we'll go on to understand what are the different type of attack vectors. You can also call them covert channels, and I will discuss this terminology in my presentation. Then we'll go through two case studies, one of which is a little lighter one and which we have performed, and the other one is taken from somewhere else, but it can be performed very easily. And then lastly, we'll talk about a few mitigation techniques. All right, so
guys, if you have any questions and all for the webinar, so you can post it on the chat box. Avni will be taking up all the questions at the end of our session.
Thank you, Prathul. So guys, please keep posting your questions. I'll be taking them at the end. Thank you. I'll start with showing you this image of a computer. You can see it is a wireless thing. And what if I tell you that you have to somehow compromise the system? What all would you suggest? So the general answers that I would expect would be sending in a phishing email with some sort of malware, or infecting it with some rootkit or some malware again, using the USB port, or doing a BLE MITM probably, because there are BLE devices here, and so on and so forth. Or network hopping or something like that, and you reach the system and you compromise it. What if I tell you that all these things are out of scope and you need to sit? So you are there in front of this computer, you cannot touch it, you are there in somewhere in the proximity, and that is all you have. Laptop, your hardware, and that is all you can do. So although this is not a proper example of an air gap system, this will somewhat give you an idea of what an air gap system is. So we come to the first question, our first agenda, that what is an air gap? So air gap is nothing but separation or isolation of your system or your network from the outside world, so that it is not connected to the outside world in any way, wired, wireless, through Wi-Fi, LAN, anything, USB. So all the physical and logical ports, logical being your network side and physical ports being things like LAN ports and USB ports, or CD drives or things like that, those are blocked in such environments. So air gap is a total isolation from the outside world. You have that system or that network is not allowed to communicate with the outside world in any way. If you remember this scene from the movie, this actor is somehow trying to exfiltrate information from an air gap system. As you can see, the setup is very looks very intimidating, and it is not your usual computer environment setup, right? So it is there, and this guy is trying to exfiltrate some sort of information out of this. So you can see that it is set up in a isolated place, physically isolated, and then virtually or network wise also it has been isolated. So we come to the major applications of such type of environments. Obviously, when you require such infrastructure and monetary investment in such type of systems, you would not want them to be there in every place, and it is not even required. So these are placed in very critical environments, such as your military environments, SCADA systems, government facilities, secret agent facilities, if you can say that, and things like that. So it is because the nature of data is very confidential and very critical in such organizations. That is why it is put in such environments and isolated from the outside world, so that we can filter out a lot of attacks before they can actually occur also. So to summarize till this point, we can say that a lot of critical facilities like military, nuclear power plants, SCADA systems, they contain data that is of very high importance and confidentiality to us. So these organizations or facilities, they deploy such critical systems in air-gapped environment. And what is an air-gapped environment? It is described as a computer or a network that has no network interfaces, either wired or wireless, and it is completely separated from the outside world. So to be able to sniff data or eavesdrop data or gather data in any way from such systems, we have a concept called covert channels. So what are the covert channels? Covert channel is basically a type of attack that creates capability. Now you will have to listen to this statement very carefully, and then I will break it down further. A covert channel is a type of attack that creates a capability to transfer information between two objects that are not supposed to be communicating. So I know it sounds a little bit vague. I'll show you an image, and then I think you'll have a better idea of what it is. This image is from Netherlands, and obviously it has snowed here, you can see, but this house has the roof has one patch where there is no snow. So what the Dutch police, they figured out that someone was growing illegal amounts of cannabis here. They were farming this, and they are not actually allowed to farm plant so much quantity of cannabis. So since it was an indoor setup, a lot of heat and everything was required, and that is for the plants to grow, and that is why there is no snow here. So covert channel here is heat. After seeing the heat signature of this house or this roof, we could identify that something illegal or maybe something different was going on in this house. Although it was later found out that they were not farming marijuana or cannabis here, they were just mining Bitcoin. So they had huge servers put up here, and the heat from those servers led this type of melting of snow, and yeah, that was it. So here heat signature was a covert channel, and it was not supposed to communicate to the outside world of the activities that were being done inside. So I hope you understood what the concept of covert channel is. Most of the techniques that are discovered or researched on in academia or by researchers are generally on creating some type of malware that infects the air gap system, or social engineering, or a combination of both. So there has been a lot of research and on different types of covert channels. So if you read about them, you'll probably be able to distinguish among the different types of covert channels that are there. So the type of covert channels I have divided them into the following: physical media. So you have physical media, you have acoustic, you have electromagnetic covert channels, you have magnetic, you have thermal, and you have light. We'll be going through a few of these in brief, and then we'll jump onto the case studies. So first, let me go through with the easiest one and the oldest form of attack vector, which is the physical media. This is one of the oldest form, and it is generally done by using USB flash drives. So everybody, I think, knows about Stuxnet. People who are in security especially know about Stuxnet. It was sent through a USB flash drive to infect the whole system. So this is one of the best examples, if you want, if you will, for exfiltration through physical media. Then you have the acoustic covert channels. So acoustic means hearing, but obviously if it is a very critical environment, it would not have speakers attached to it for our entertainment. So obviously we're not talking about speakers here. We are talking about different types of components which are inside our systems and which make noise. This sounds very vague, but there have been practical demonstrations done by a lot of researchers which show us that this is actually possible. So there is a very good example of this. There's a malware called Fansmitter, which was created by some researchers at a university. And what that Fansmitter does is it collects sounds from your system, from the fan that is there, the cooling fan that is inside your system, and it tries to analyze what information is being processed. So it uses the sound of this inside your system, the sound of the cooling fan, and it analyzes. So it was revealed that it can actually reveal the entire data. That is, if you're sending a password, unencrypted password, and it's so obviously inside the system it is doing some sort of processing inside the system, it is unencrypted, and you can find out the exact password what it was processing. Then you have one of the most researched on covert channels. So electromagnetic covert channel is something which is discussed in detail by a lot of researchers. They have created a lot of malwares, a lot of techniques to be able to bridge this gap between to be able to use electromagnetic in our favor from an attacker point of view. So it makes use of power sampling, voltage sampling to understand what is the exact behavior of the device, whether it's doing a normal operation versus a cryptographic operation, what type of cryptographic operation, and so forth. Then we have a very interesting covert channel called the light covert channel or the optical covert channel. So here, this is a diagram which is taken from the internet, but it was this concept was very well explained at a Black Hat conference. What those people did was they somehow made a malware and then put it into the system, and they used, so the how the working of the malware was, you flash light onto it while the scanner is scanning any document, and you flash different types of light, either visible or infrared, any type of light, and then it will send, the light is supposed to send commands to the system, and the system will follow those commands. So that was a very interesting talk. If you want, you can Google Black Hat, I think 2014. Then we discuss our last covert channel, that is a thermal covert channel. The example that I showed you of that house with snow is also of the same category. They use heat emitted from processing to identify what type of processing is being done by the system. So it can be, in that case, it was a house. In our case, it could be heat emitted from the system, or it could be heat emitted through the screen of a system, and we are able to analyze it in our own way and find what type of data is being processed. So this was all the introduction part to make you more familiar about what are air gaps, what a covert channel is. Covert channels are also called side channels because they are obviously not the intended mode of communication, but they are the counterpart, they are the side channels which are unintentionally leaking some sort of information. Now we'll move on to some case studies. So our objective for the case study is to be able to use one of these or a combination of these to be able to sniff data or eavesdrop. The motive is not to present it in a bad light, but if we as security analysts and researchers want to prevent these things from happening, we have to study them from the point of view of an attacker. So first case is called sniffing data of an HDMI cable through RF leakage. So now we did this as a part of a CTF that was organized, but we found out that it can be done with a lot more accuracy using some other tools and stuff at home when we came back. So I'll show you some of the screenshots from there. Unfortunately, I cannot show you the demo. I do not have the hardware required for it. So let me explain what this sentence is first of all. So HDMI cable, we all know what an HDMI cable is. It is used to project data and audio from one device to another. Both have to be HDMI compliant. That is the objective of an HDMI cable, nothing more. Then we are sniffing or eavesdropping data. And what are we using? We are using two things basically, not only RF leakage. We are using RF leakage, which is radio frequency leakage, along with proximity. So we have to have some sort of proximity to the system to be able to do this type of attack. So why only RF? Every device, if it is not shielded, or if it is it is not using any countermeasure to such type of attack, will have some sort of leaking content. Can be through in the form of RF, it can be through voltage fluctuations, it can be through current fluctuations, and all those things can be studied. So here we are using RF leakage from an HDMI cable. So what our setup is, we have one system which is connected to, let's say, a projector or another bigger screen to show the data, and that is it for the victim side. And on the attacker side, we have the following. We have hardware and software. Hardware, obviously, if you are going to capture some sort of leakage or anything, you're obviously going to have an antenna. An antenna could be as expensive as you want. So if you want a very high strength antenna and you want to perform this attack from a very large range, from a few meters, 15 meters, 15 plus meters away, you can use a very high power antenna with a high gain. Here, for the sake of the experiment, we used HAC-RF1. You can use yardstick or a very cheap antenna called the RTL-SDR. So what is an SDR? SDR is short for Software Defined Radio. Now, everybody knows what a radio is. It is used to capture the FM AM signals and converts them, and then we can hear the sound, right? But what is software defined radio? So all these components which are present in the hardware of a radio, that is modulators, demodulators, amplifiers, things like that, which are there inside the hardware, are implemented in the software form. This gives us the flexibility to be able to put in our transformations over it. If you want that your signal should be processed with a fast Fourier transformation, you can just plug it in the software and it will make a fast Fourier transformation. You will not require any other hardware, additional hardware, to do that. So it is very easy for people like us as researchers and people who play with waves and electromagnetic waves. For them, it is very easy to change it, to process it, to filter it, and basically perform many operations over it. So that is the hardware side that we require. Now for the software side, we have two softwares that we are going to use. The first one is SDR Sharp, and the next is Tempest SDR. So for using SDR Sharp, you have to know the frequency or the refresh rate of the target monitor. You have to know a couple of different things, frame rate, all those things of the target monitor. But obviously, as an attacker, you would not know all these things beforehand. So we created, there are already some autocorrelation graphs, which loosely translates to brute forcing scripts, which are already available, but we tweaked them a bit for our experiment. And you can brute force them into the config, and you can make these changes in the SDR Sharp config file, which I'll show you in some time. And then you can play the software. And the Tempest SDR can be hooked up with any SDR software, so SDR hardware, sorry. So like HAC-RF, Yardstick, RTL-SDR, ASPI, all those things, it can be hooked up with them. And it already has a support for these type of hardware. And then you can actually make out from this those frequencies that you have captured, you can make out what the original data that the victim system is transmitting. You can completely convert it into a proper image. So we'll now start with the steps on how to perform these. But before going into the steps, I would say that every hardware requires different setup, different debugging, different changing of parameters, tweaking. So I will not go into the details of how we configured HAC-RF1 and how we edited the files or the hardware or the DLL file or whatever interfaces. I'm not going into that. I'll give you a set of general steps that you can follow with any hardware that you get. So for us, the first step was to set up the HAC-RF by installing drivers and things, very basic things like that. Next step was to install the SDR Sharp and then make it work with the HAC-RF1, the hardware that we have and the software that we have. We have to make changes in the SDR Sharp config file so that both of them work seamlessly. So what happens here is you open up this file, this config file, which comes with the SDR Sharp software, and you make changes to it. Now you can have, it has overwhelming number of settings that you can apply. it can have your details relating to the correlation graphs, that is the automating scripts. What should the step size be? What should the gradient be? And details which are specific to HackRF or your hardware only. So you have to basically feed all that information into this config file. Then you can move on to hitting the play button. When you hit the play button, you will start capturing the data or the noise, because till this point it is still noise to us. It is not meaningful information. You can hit play and you will start gathering that information, and then you will see something like this. So in this graph, this is called a waterfall that I earlier talked about. This is a waterfall model of the noise that we have gathered. We have to filter out or probably identify the area that we want to analyze. So you can see here the most, we can see some peaks here, and you have to identify these peaks and play with them on the interference graphs, and you will be able to at least minimize your scope for later assessment. So you minimize that scope here, and this output of SDR Sharp is used as an input for Tempest SDR. So now we are moving to the other software, that is the Tempest SDR. So for Tempest SDR, we have to set it up again with the HackRF to be able to capture and correlate the data from SDR Sharp and HackRF. You play with the frequencies here, play with the L pass and gain here after you get that noise, and you filter out a lot of things. You have to adjust a lot of parameters here. I will not go into what adjustments and what changes we made, because that will be different with respect to what type of RF you have. So since I told you we did this for a CTF, I have a screenshot of how and what the screen looked like for us for capturing the flag. So we are setting up the hardware in this screenshot, and then we get something like this. So on this screen, you're able to see the flag, which is printed on the victim screen. So this image is not very cleared because obviously we got very excited on seeing the result, and we stopped it and we entered the flag. But here you can see there are two parameters called L-pass and gain. And L-pass is basically for your image stabilization. So you play with L-pass and reduce the gain a little bit, and you will be able to see a perfect image of what the victim machine is showing. Right. So this was our first case study that we performed on our own. The second case study, the screenshots and the images are not my own, but I have done some part of it as a hobby, you can say. So the second one is called Sniffing Energy Levels to Guess Cryptographic Algorithms. So I talked about taking traces of power and taking traces of voltage, and then analyzing what type of cryptographic algorithm is deployed. So we are going to see that in a minute. But before that, I would like to clarify that it is not a flaw of the algorithm. The algorithm is perfectly fine. We are able to do this, and we are able to extract the entire key because of the fact that there are no countermeasures like shielding and all in place to defend against such type of attacks, such type of sniffing attacks, to be clear. So I'll show you the first slide. As you can see, this is a power trace. Now this power trace has some component which is repeating again and again. If you count them, these are 10 rounds being performed of the same thing, and then the last round has some sort of difference. it is not completed fully. You can already guess what type of algorithm this is, because what algorithm, what is a block cipher that would repeat itself after one round and for 10 rounds. So this is AES that we are performing here, and you can see that even in one block there is one darker component and lighter component. So the darker component reflects lower voltage fluctuations or requirements, and the lighter one represents higher voltage fluctuations or higher usage of energy there. So by looking at this, you can narrow down to a great extent that this is only this is AES only. And to further go and analyze what is the key that is being computed here, that is being used to compute an AES text, what you can do is send this power trace through a device which does this computation for you. So in professional world, people use very high-end devices, oscilloscopes and whatnot, to perform these type of devices. For me, as a hobbyist, I use Chip Whisperer, which is much cheaper, and it comes with its own target board, so you can try this. This is called simple power analysis, and you can brute force what key is being used. And if you want to know more about these type of attacks and you want to learn more, there's amazing information available on the Chip Whisperer page. And you can also follow Colin O'Flynn, who has created Chip Whisperer, or you can simply Google simple power analysis or differential power analysis, and you'll get a lot of detail. This is not something new that we are doing. These type of attacks have been there for a while, but they are gaining attraction now, because these type of attacks are being done on microprocessors and embedded systems more and more nowadays. Next image that I'm going to show you is another cryptographic algorithm. It has, as you can see, again, it is a current versus time graph, and you can see that some operation is being performed again and again. If you count the number of rounds and you correlate it, you will find that this is DES. And this is a DES algorithm, and in the same way, you can even find out what key is being deployed here. I will repeat again that it is not the flaw of the algorithm, it is the flaw of the device that is making this computation, because there are no countermeasures in place to protect against such type of attacks. With this, we complete both our case studies and we come to our final mitigation techniques. So since I've already mentioned in the talk a lot of times that we have to have proper shielding mechanisms, that is one of the mitigation techniques. You do not allow these type of leakage to go outside so that it cannot be analyzed any further. You can also mask the signal by introducing intentional noise. So if your device is making some sort of noise in any way, RF noise or acoustic noise or anyway, and you have another component inside the device which makes an intentional noise, you can reduce the probability of data sniffing and data extraction through that to quite an extent. You cannot eliminate the possibility, but you can for sure minimize it. You can have systems set up like Faraday's cage, which do not leak any information outside. There is also one more very interesting mitigation techniques. You can introduce clock cycle delays. So for example, we saw that AES has a particular signature, just like viruses have their signatures. AES has a particular signature power trace. So if you introduce some random delays, that power signature will be altered, and the attacker would not come to a strong conclusion. He cannot come to a strong conclusion that this is definitely AES or DES or whatever cryptographic algorithm. So with this mitigation technique, I come to an end. And if you guys have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Pratul sir, over to you.
Yeah. Okay. So yes, this was an interesting session. I guess people who are interested in air gaps, they found your session to be really interesting. We do have a question of Puneet. I have popped it in on the screen. You can have a look.
Okay. As per my understanding, side channel attack possible when hardware and software compatible. No, it is not necessary when you have a compatibility issue between hardware and software. They can be performed if the hardware itself is not properly shielded or protected. At that time, you can perform these side channel attacks. It is not a software issue. To be specific, it is not software specific, it is hardware which is creating the problem here.
Okay. Yes. So guys, if you have any other question, Avni is here, she can take up your questions. So Avni, will you be can you just post a link of the Black Hat talk which you had mentioned and the other?
Yeah, sure. Actually, it's there in the presentation itself. If
okay, fine.
So it's here, already here.
Okay.
And all these different types of attacks that I have mentioned, their links, I'll post it along with this. They're there in the notes or somewhere there. Okay.
Okay. Siddharth has asked one question.
Okay, how do we prevent it? So I already discussed a few mitigation techniques. The mitigation can be only to minimize these type of attacks. We cannot eliminate these because there is always a chance that the intentional noise that we are creating or the clock cycles we are randomizing, they are studied and analyzed and then finally broken. So we can minimize these by masking the signals, creating intentional noise and things like this. Yeah, that is how it is generally mitigated.
Okay. So Avni, we will be, and all other attendees, we will be sharing the slides and she will be posting in the same on to, we'll be sharing it on our OWASP LinkedIn SlideShare account and also on our Swachlit link of her talk. So thank you, Avni. Thank you for this talk.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Yep. Bye-bye. So guys, here's the end of another great one of the webinars which we are having. We are planning upon doing it every weekend. So if you all are interested, please drop in a message on the comment section and please give us a buzz on the social media so we can get in touch with you. If you want to get in, if you want to have your session as well on our series. Thank you so much. Hope to see you all soon. Stay safe. Bye-bye.